Okay, I'd like to thank you all for coming again today. And I'd like to thank the Commons and Michael Lardner and the rest of the staff for making this possible. And I was also asked to alert everyone to the fact that Roxanne Dunbar Ortiz will be speaking here on Wednesday, September 24th at 7:30 p.m. I believe that flyers for the event are available at the front desk. Okay. So today, for those who weren't here last week, we're going to be focusing on Hubert Harrison, the voice of Harlem radicalism, in this book, also known as the Father of Harlem Radicalism, one of the true giants of U.S. history and black history and Afro-Caribbean history. And we're going to start getting into it with the slides. We're going to run quite a number of slides today. I'll try and comment on the slides, but if I recommend people get where they can read the slides easily. Okay, first off, this book, and for the people who were here last week, we're going to do just a brief overview of what we did last week, and then we'll get into the actual story of Harrison's life. But this biography came out from Columbia University Press a few years ago. Hubert Harrison, The Voice of Harlem Radicalism, 1883 to 1918. Harrison actually lives till 1927. He dies young at age 44. It is the first multi-volume biography, or it will be when completed, the first multi-volume biography of an Afro-Caribbean and only the fifth of an African-American after Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois, Langston Hughes, and Martin Luther King Jr. He is a giant, as I said, of black history. And this particular book, which people can take a look at on the table in the back, is over 600 pages, it's 116 pages of footnotes, and it's 60 photos with detailed scholarship. It is, with detailed footnotes. It is serious scholarship, right? And this is because we think that's important for those who are really interested in the topic to be able to pursue and pursue their interest areas and check the accuracy of what's being said and take it further, actually. So that's volume one. Here's Harrison. He is born in St. Croix. At the time, it's the Virgin Islands. Today, it's the U.S. Virgin Islands. When he's born there, DWI is Danish West Indies. It was a colony of Denmark. He arrives in New York City in 1900. He's a brilliant writer, orator, educator, critic, and political activist, and arguably one of the most extraordinary intellectual activists of the 20th century. We also have on the table in the back a Hubert Harrison reader, which contains 138 of his 700 articles. I edited this in 2001. It was published by Wesleyan University Press. It breaks down into his developing worldview, his class radicalism, his race radicalism, his anti-imperialism, his theater reviews, his just fascinating topics. I encourage people to look at it. We have people here from Brooklyn, from North Jersey, from Queens. All those library systems have these books, so people can access them. I recommend that people look at it. And regarding Harrison's writings, been able to locate over 700 articles, and I'm in the process of trying to put all 700 up with edited introductions on Columbia University's Rare Book and Library Manuscript, Rare Book and Manuscript Library website for free worldwide. That's the project. This is the web page. Anyone taking notes, it's simply my name. If you don't have a pen or pencil, just remember my name. If you Google that, you can come to a web page with all kinds of free information about Hubert Harrison and about Theodore W. Allen, the other person we're talking about in this course, and videos, audios, print material. And I also want to call your attention to the fact that at that web page, on the top left, is an article, The Developing Conjuncture, The Developing Crisis, and some insights from Hubert Harrison and Theodore W. Allen on the centrality of the fight against white supremacy. It's a big, long article. And at the last four pages, I explain the history of the article, which people might find of interest. And that article is an overview of sorts of what we're going to be doing in this five-week session here. Moving on, I like to open when I do talks on Harrison with his message to the youth. I think this is the kind of thing we want to disseminate to today's youth. Just wonderful wisdom, I think. And what he writes is, prepare by knowing and never think you know until you have listened to 10 others who know differently and have survived the shock. Never bow the knee to Baal because Baal is in power. Never respect wrong and injustice because they are enshrined in the sacred institutions of our glorious land. Read, reason, and think on all sides of all subjects, and set it before you as a sacred duty, always to surpass the teachers that taught you. I think it's very inspiring. You get a little sense of the independent, critical thinker that Harrison was, right? Hubert Harrison, brilliant intellectual, race and class conscious, radical internationalist. And he defines himself as a radical internationalist. This is Joel A. Rogers in his book, World's Great Men of Color, two volumes, 1947, first published. Rogers, like Harrison, is an autodidact, a working class intellectual and scholar, great historian of the black experience, a Pullman porter, does important coverage of the struggle against the fascists in Abyssinia, Ethiopia, in the 1930s for the Pittsburgh Courier, and a close personal friend of Harrison. And he describes Hubert Harrison as the foremost Afro-American intellect of his era. And that's amidst chapters, this is in World's Great Men of Color, amidst chapters on Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois, William Monroe Trotter, and Marcus Garvey. So that's extraordinary high praise coming from Rogers. And he goes on in that same passage to say, and he was the leader with the sanest program. Right? Here's Harrison in 1926 on 135th Street. I believe this picture is in the building owned by the Urban League. But in that year, Harrison was teaching courses on world problems of race, both here at this group, which is called the International, I'm not recalling the title right now, International Socialist Study Group of some sort. And he also taught the same class at the Worker School, which was the Communist Party School in 1926. I'll just point out for people here several things about this photo. Right here on the far left is Richard B. Moore, the famed Scottsboro orator, originally a member of the African Blood Brotherhood and the Socialist Party before he comes with the Communist Party. He also ran the Frederick Douglass Bookstore in Harlem on 125th Street. His major collection of over 15,000 books is at the University of the West Indies in Cave Hill, Barbados. His daughter, who's a wonderful historian in her own right, is in her 90s now, Joyce Moore Turner. I spoke with her 2 days ago, very recently again. And she has written two excellent books, Richard B. Moore, Caribbean Militant in Harlem, and Caribbean Crusaders of the Harlem Renaissance. So you have Richard B. Moore there. Then you have W.A. Domingo. W.A. Domingo is from Moore is from Barbados. Domingo, with the book in front of him right there, which is going to be a gift to Harrison, was a boyhood friend of Marcus Garvey in Jamaica. He's a socialist. He becomes the first editor of Marcus Garvey's Negro World, and he is also very active in the late 30s, early 40s, in the movement for independence in the West Indies. With Norman Manley, the father of Michael Manley, that people may be familiar with here in this audience. Also right here, and we have some educators, I believe, in the group, but you have Williana Jones Burroughs. Her granddaughter's here in Brooklyn. She was a school teacher in New York. She ran for city council, communist. Before that, she was very active in the old teachers union, right? The one from the 30s. And she goes to the Soviet Union during World War II and does an English language program for a number of years during World War II. She writes some wonderful things about Harrison later on, but a couple of other things. Her husband, Charles Burroughs, is one of the founders of the Kriegwa Players in the basement of the 135th Street Public Library, one of the early black theater groups. And Charles Burroughs is a postal worker like Harrison. They used to have a study group, and these folks would get off that night shift, which I can relate to, and at 2 and 3 in the morning, they'd be having their study group, right? And Harrison documents this in his diary. But they, like Harrison, also passed it on, and the son of Williana and Charles Burroughs, named Charles Burroughs, was co-founder with his wife in Chicago of the DuSable Museum, which is a major African-American museum in the country. In the far back, I believe in the hat, is Hermie, I forgive my pronunciation, I believe it's Weiswood, it might be Weiswood, who's from Dutch Guiana, well, she's actually from Guyana. Her husband was from Dutch Guiana. She's from Guyana, British Guiana at the time. And they were very active in the international communist movement. And more has been coming out about her and her life within recent years. And the other thing I want to just point out, as Joyce Moore Turner mentioned to me, and I mentioned this last week, I believe there's 68 people in this audience. The men seem to have jackets and ties for the most part. But Joyce Moore Turner emphasized, Jeff, please tell your audience, these are probably working people. They would dress up at night when they came to these talks, but they probably, many of them were wearing service uniforms during the day, right? And Harrison, of course, was deeply rooted amongst working people, the common people, which was a phrase he and Allen used with genuine affection and feeling of oneness. You know, they were of the people. Going on, I just want to, again, brief introduction. Harrison is an intellectual, Harrison is a radical, and then we'll get into the particulars of the story. After Harrison comes to the U.S. in 1900, he's an immigrant, he's working 5 days a week, a couple nights, he's an orphan, right? His parents have. So, New York World, one of New York dailies, runs a headline, "Genius found in West Indian student." They had never seen anybody like this. He's barely going to school, he's getting citywide honors, winning awards in Latin, and another subject, and so they featured that headline and spoke about him. He spoke or read 6 languages. This is based on going through his diary in particular, because you can see when he breaks into other languages, including what I found of great interest, besides the Latin expertise, if you will. This is to some varying degree, right? You know, but he also, in his last years, was teaching himself Arabic and reading the Quran, not because he's religious, but because it's a religion of so many people of African descent. He read voraciously. I went through some of the indicators of this last week. It was said when he died, he read several books a day. I know that sounds quite intimidating, particularly nowadays when people don't read so many books. But he knew how to aggressively attack books. I've seen it in the books that remained from his collection. He would hone in on what he wanted to focus on and really go after it. He also kept, as part of his papers, which are now at Columbia University, which I preserved, indexed, and inventoried for many years, were scrapbooks. And he kept all kinds of newspaper clippings and articles in very organized fashion. That's how he kept his files in that day. So he did read voraciously. He was an orator, pioneering soapbox orator, all kinds of subjects, history, science, politics, education, literature, theater, evolution, both outdoor and indoor. But he really pioneered, and we'll get into this as we go on today, in the tradition of soapbox oratory, particularly in Harlem. But he was also involved in very important free speech struggles, just the right to speak on street corners, 14th Street, Buffalo, New York, various places where he, you know, faced police harassment and sometimes arrest, right? As an intellectual, as I indicated, it's over 700 now, 700 pieces that we've located, hopefully we'll put online. He edited a number of publications. The first one he was an editor of, the other ones he was the principal editor of. But the masses, for those not familiar with it, was the leading left literary publication of the decade between 1910 and 1920. John Reed and other people were affiliated with it, Max Eastman. The Voice is the first newspaper of the new Negro movement. He edits it from 1917 to 1919. That is 8 full years before Alain Locke and everything we've been taught in school about the new Negro movement, 1925. and that Alain Locke New Negro Movement is generally depicted as a middle-class arts-based movement. Harrison's New Negro Movement was based in social and political radicalism, and activism. But every paper he was the principal editor of also contained book review sections and poetry for the people, so it was incredibly literary. He edits The New Negro in 1919, 6 years before Locke. Notice the title. New Negro, intended as an organ of the international consciousness of the darker races, especially of the Negro race. In 1920, he becomes principal editor of Marcus Garvey's Negro World. And under his editorship, that paper sweeps the globe. And Harrison does a host of things, and in this book, he talks about how he reshapes the Negro world, and it'll be in volume two. But everything from how he handles headlines to how he edits pieces, but he also does some important innovative things in the paper, including bringing lots of international writers to publish in the Negro world, but he starts the West Indian News Notes column, the book review section, the poetry for the people section, Negro World.
Jeff, was he working in the post office all this time?
No, we're going to get into that today. He starts working the post office in 1907, but he is fired in late 1910, early 1911, in that period, through the efforts of Booker T. Washington, which we will get into. And I'm a postal worker for 33 years, so I was able to dig up his records. You know, I knew how to research the records that were available, and we'll talk about that. As a critic, he's a brilliant literary critic and theater critic, and the praise comes from many sources, including Eugene O'Neill, who wins Nobel Prize for Literature in 1936, after Harrison does a review of The Emperor Jones. When Harrison reviewed it, the lead was not Paul Robeson, which people are with later, but it was Charles Gilpin, who was the leading black actor of that early period, right? And Harrison writes a review, and O'Neill's taken away by it. And he says, wow, this is superb. Any theater I have anything to do with, you have a role in, right? Harrison himself describes himself as the first regular book reviewer in Negro newspaperdom, which seems to be some reason why people might want to include him in literature courses, black literature courses, and things like that, although I do not know that he is so included at this point. We've located 68 to 70 reviews just on him as a reviewer. He starts writing front page New York Times Saturday Review of Book pieces on literary criticism in 1907. Now it's the Sunday Review of Books. It used to be the Saturday. He's working in the post office, working at night shift, and he's publishing front page articles on literary criticism in the Times. As I mentioned last week, there's a National Book Critics Executive Board, or there was a few years ago when I last looked it up, and two members, Eric Bank, who I believe lives in Brooklyn, and Scott McNamee, who's in Washington, both contained pieces from Hubert Harrison on how to review books on their webpage, right? Still on Harrison as an intellectual, he is a pioneer black activist in the socialist movement, the free thought movement. Free thought is thought free of religious dogma, unfettered by religion. Very important in that period. It was a movement of some significance. Again, we'll talk about this today. But it's also significant because it's a break from the black church, the most powerful institution in the black community. So we'll talk about that dynamic a little. He's also active in the birth control movement. He comes out of Branch 5 of the Socialist Party with Margaret Sanger, but he also was aware of genocidal aspects of that movement and spoke on that. He's a promoter and aide to black writers and artists, Augusta Savage, the sculptor, Claude McKay, the poet, Joel Rogers, UB Blake, the musician, and the list goes on, because he understood very well the relation between art and politics, and he gave some leeway to the artists. He didn't try and dictate to them, right? He was a featured lecturer for the New York City Board of Education from 1922 to 1926. I believe he was the only black lecturer, and this is when the principal form of adult education was talks and presentations in public libraries and in schools in the evening, because people worked, right? And so he did that for 4 years. He also, though, although he never went to college a day in his life, he delivered lectures, series of lectures at NYU and at Columbia. Particularly, it always puts a smile on my face when he spoke in 1926 on the Canton Uprising and delivered a series of lectures on China at Columbia and NYU. You know, he had some breadth of perspective, right? And he was a bibliophile, a lover of books. He would sell books when he spoke on a street corner, right? I mean, he lived, after he gets fired from the post office, the question, living in poverty most of the rest of his life, right? So he would sell books when he did his talks. Also a library popularizer. He thought that free public libraries were one of the great institutions in this country. He wrote wonderful essays like Read, 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 inspirational little pieces like the one, The Message to the Youth, that I showed you earlier. And he and Arthur Schomburg, James Weldon, Schomburg and Harris in particular, were two of the five founding officers of the 135th Street Public Library committee that set up the Division on Negro Literature, History, and Prints, which is what grew into the Schomburg Center, right? And in 1930, I believe, after he dies, his portrait was hung at the entrance to the library, although nowadays I don't think they've been able to locate that picture, but that's the esteem he was held in, right? Going on. Now we're going to just briefly introduction as a radical. This is A. Philip Randolph, 1963, at the March on Washington. He describes Hubert Harrison as the father of Harlem radicalism. It's in a period when Harlem is considered the center of radical black thought and the international Negro Mecca. This was the place. People were coming, much ferment of ideas, much activism. He was deeply influenced by Harrison, as were many others who I list and I go through and I offer some of their comments, particularly in the biography, Volume 1. Hubert Harrison is the only person in United States history in this period, but it's arguable in United States history throughout, to play signal leading roles in the largest class radical and the largest race radical movement of his era. We'd think people would pay a little more attention to him, right? As a class radical, he's the foremost black organizer, agitator, and theoretician in the Socialist Party during its 1912 heyday. Many of the historians say that was the high point of the Socialist Party, you know, and that Eugene Debs is running for president, big campaigns, very active in New York, where Harrison was. He's also an extraordinary race radical, and played truly signal role in the race radical movements as the founder and first organization of the he founded the first organization, the Liberty League, and the first newspaper, The Voice, of the New Negro Movement in 1917. People are not familiar with that New Negro Movement. In some ways, it's like the Black Power Movement of the 1960s, right? And we'll get more specifically into what its demands were, what it was pushing, but it's a movement of great significance. Robert A. Hill is the leading historian of the Garvey Movement, and he emphasizes that the Garvey Movement was a component part of this New Negro Movement. Harrison is also, in terms of his race radicalism, as I said earlier, the editor of the Negro World and the principal radical influence on the Garvey Movement, particularly during the 1920 radical high point of that movement. Much of this will be coming out in Volume 2, but we can talk a little about it today. And that's the period when he's the principal editor up through the end of August of that publication, Negro World. Harrison profoundly influenced a generation of new Negro militants and common people. I've argued in my various writings that amongst his generation of activists, he is the most class conscious of the race radicals and the most race conscious of the class radicals. He was, by accounts of contemporaries, and in Randolph's case, from Randolph, the major radical influence on A. Philip Randolph. Well known particularly for his class radicalism, the major radical influence on Marcus Garvey. When I grow up, when some of the folks in this audience grow up, that's Martin and Malcolm. Those lines of descent come down to Martin and Malcolm, because it's Martin who marches with Randolph at the March on Washington. Randolph is at his side in 1963. And for those who don't know it, Malcolm's mother was a reporter for the Negro World, the same paper that Harrison had been principal editor of, and his father was a Garveyite preacher, right? So there are some lines, important lines of descent there. I argue that Hubert Harrison is a key ideological link in these two wings of the civil rights black liberation struggle. we want to look and study him to see what, you know, what, how he could influence both, you know, both wings of the movement. And we see what he's saying. As a radical internationalist, he was extremely knowledgeable on Africa, Asia, the Mideast, the Americas, and Europe. I mentioned the historian Winthrop James, Winston James, last week, an excellent historian who's written on holding aloft a banner about early 20th century Caribbean radicalism. He's written other fine books, and he points out that amongst his contemporaries, Hubert Harrison knew more about and spoke and wrote more knowledgeably about Africa than any of his contemporaries, but he did so without the arrogance that so often comes from people from this country towards people from Africa. And he's wonderful pieces on Africa. You'll find a number of them in the reader. On Asia, as I mentioned, he lectures on the Canton Uprising. He writes on Asia. I have scholars from India writing me today saying the pieces he writes on India in the late teens are the best they see coming out of the U.S. in this period. He writes on the Mideast, the Americas, Europe. He's an extraordinary internationalist. Last week I had a very moving passage from him on how he considered himself an internationalist, and I think we'll have it later today or next week. Overall, Hubert Harrison's approach, he's race conscious, he's class conscious, he's scientific, turns to science, not religion, to address social problems. He's an internationalist. He emphasizes the common people. On that theme, this is very different than the talented tenth and people, you know, live. Harrison lives, when he lives in Harlem, he lives at 231 West 134th Street. It's the most densely populated block in Harlem. When he first comes to New York, he lives on West 62nd Street. And I'll show you a building on 63rd Street, which is where Monk grows up 20 years later, you know, the tenements he lives in. But and that area had 3,500 people, African-American and Afro-Caribbean, and the tenements were considered the meanest in New York. That was the area before the IRT gets completed. That's where people, you know, African, Afro-Caribbeans lived. 3,500 people in five blocks, and that's where Harrison lived. So he's rooted amongst the people, and his children would tell me how when he would walk down the street, the kids all knew, you know, he was of the people, right? No heirs. Okay, Harrison's approach, it was a mass approach. He, in his day, the two principal means of reaching the masses were soapbox oratory, getting out there on the street, and newspapers, and he was really a master of both. He actually did two radio shows. Radio was in its infancy, right? And one at Cooper Union, and another one for a radio station that the material may still be in the Edison archives, which are out in Jersey. There's over a million items in those archives that are still on catalog. He understands the interrelation of literature and the arts. He is anti-capitalist, anti-imperialist, and throughout his work, and his children wanted me to always emphasize when I speak before crowds, remember, he was race conscious, he opposed white supremacy, wanted to challenge white supremacy. All right, this is Arthur Schomburg. Schomburg delivered the eulogy at Harrison's funeral. Schomburg is Afro-Puerto Rican. He had been in study groups or in lyceums with Harrison from the first decade of the 20th century when Harrison arrived. He, you know, he's the person for whom the Schomburg Center is named and whose collection was the basis for what developed into it. And when he delivered the eulogy at Harrison's funeral, he knew how popular Harrison was in his day, but he also said he was ahead of his time. And that's important because I think he has so much to offer us today. And last week I had a follow-up quote 70 years later from John Henry Clark saying basically the same thing. I don't think I have it here today because I'm cutting down a little. Hubert Harrison, this is his unmarked shared plot in Woodlawn Cemetery in the Bronx. Recently a down payment has been made by the family, and I'm going to a meeting actually at 2 o'clock today with some people who were involved in trying, we want to start commemorating it, right? And as soon as we get more information actually get the marker gets placed, we will let people know. And we want to have that the plot marked. But it's right now it's an unmarked shared plot. And I use that photo oftentimes because it's in many ways it reflects things such as the poverty Harrison and his family lived in, the lack of recognition he's received for all these years. But it also kind of inspires us to do a little more on this. And we have Issa and Marlo here in the audience, and there are some other folks that we, about 2 years ago, I guess, we got petitions up there on 130, right outside the Schomburg Center. We followed all the protocols for having a street renamed. The intent was to have 134th Street in Lenox, which had not been renamed, that stretched from there down one block, renamed after Hubert Harrison, because 134th and Lenox, in Harrison's day, they used to call it Liberty Corner after Harrison's efforts in his soapbox oratory and things like that. That's where the Harlem tradition of soapbox oratory really began. And it was passed unanimously by Community Board 10, and then we were subsequently told by the higher-ups that there was a moratorium on naming, so. Although we've got unanimous approval and we've got all the signatures, nothing has been done yet, but I think others will be able to pick up on that struggle too. All right, so Harrison, why is he not better known? Very briefly, I'm just going to hit the topics. We, you know, over time we can get into a lot of this. He's poor, he's working class, he's black, he's foreign born, he's from the Caribbean, and as I said last week, if he was a woman, these are all categories that have been seriously underrepresented in our historical treatments. He is a radical in the most powerful country in the world on race, class, and religion, so in many ways it's not surprising we don't know more about him. He is a forthright critic, and J.A. Rogers emphasizes this. He's you saw his message to the youth, and we'll get into his training at St. Benedict the Moor's Church, with all these very, they really nurtured in each other real integrity in terms of discussion and debate. And so Harrison, if he objected or disagreed, he would state his reasons. He'd state it openly, without beating the devil around the stump, as he would say. There's no mean spiritedness in it. He was trying to push the struggle forward. It's the type of approach I think we need very badly today. But he was a forthright critic, and many people couldn't handle the criticism, and he paid the price in some respects for that. He had no long-lasting organizational ties. Garvey has the Garvey Movement, you know, that kept his memory alive. Du Bois in later years was affiliated with the Communist Party, which kept his memory alive. Harrison didn't have those long-lasting organizational ties. He dies young at 44, unexpectedly, from appendicitis in Bellevue Hospital in Manhattan. He's not martyred like Malcolm and Martin, and he doesn't live 50 years more like Du Bois, right? And the last question, the last reason that I usually cite is how history is written in the U.S., and we can talk about this more later on. I gave some examples last week. But so amongst the people he challenged in his life, just to get, first off, he's challenging Teddy Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson and Carnegie, you know, all the powers that be and the Rockefellers and all of that and the elected officials. But he also speaks out and at various points criticizes important left and labor and black leaders. So amongst those he will criticize, yes?
What do you mean when you say criticize? Is he just disagreeing with them or does he
denounce them? Well, what I mean, and I'm going to give you some examples. I'm going to give you today examples of Booker T. Washington and Du Bois, if you can hold on for that. Okay. But I just want, just so we can keep flowing, Booker T. Washington, most powerful black man in America, W.E.B. Du Bois, Marcus Garvey, Chandler Owen was the cohort of A. Philip Randolph in that early period, very active in the socialist movement. Charles W. Anderson was the leading black Republican in New York. He's actually involved with Booker T. Washington and Harrison's getting fired from the post office. Left labor and literary figures, Mary White Ovington is in the Socialist Party. Oswald Garrison Villard, Ernest Unterman, Kate Richards. These are leading socialists, Jolie Spingarn, who's also the head of the NAACP, right? And we'll get into that hopefully today. In the labor movement, Samuel Gompers, William Z. Foster, very dominant figure in the history of the Communist Party. And after Foster does a book on the Great Steel Strike in which he If you look up Negroes in the index, you won't barely find it. But when he does mention them, he talks about the Negroes having the mind of a child. So people should know this. People coming from the left. Yeah, I'm not making this up. Right? Yeah. That's in the Great Steel Strike. So Harrison's critical, and then he goes on from there. We'll talk about this later. Carl Van Vechten, who writes on the Harlem Renaissance, and amongst the organizations that Harrison criticizes are the AFL, the Socialist Party, the Communist Party, the Urban League, and the like. Yes?
You use the term Harlem Renaissance, and Hubert Harrison had a particular take on that terminology. Could you share that with us?
Yes, very briefly, but again, we're going to go into his life right soon. Renaissance is a rebirth, and Harrison's basic criticism of the concept of the Harlem Renaissance was, to those who were promoting it as such, he said, well, if they knew their history better, they would know that there was a continuous flow from black writers and authors, you know, particularly from the Civil War period on, that was being ignored and neglected. That was number one. And number two, he said what is largely considered the Harlem Renaissance is a creation of many white people like Van Vechten, who we just cited, who he criticizes. That's in brief, but Harrison says he's far more articulate than I am. But all right, now we're gonna get into Harrison's life. It's what we didn't get to do last week, so we're gonna talk a little history. He grows up in St. Croix, Danish West Indies. In the period when Harrison's born, from 1883 on, St. Croix has between 20 and 30,000 people. Right? Not a big island. Capitalist agriculture, and it has a history of slavery. People on the island are colonial subjects. Only 475 people out of 23,000 have the right to vote, right? There are African customs, which Harrison talks about, and this is one very rich thing about his experience. He knows the African traditions and where they come from and how they function in St. Croix, and I'm going to show you a few quotes. Very importantly, we talked about this last time, the color line is drawn differently, color line if you will, is drawn differently in St. Croix than in the U.S. This is very important for understanding what happens with Harrison, Claude McKay, Garvey, and many of those Afro-Caribbean immigrants who come. We will talk about that. But it's got to do with how social control is maintained, the history of how class struggle has been undertaken in those countries, and the demographics, a host of things. Again, we'll get into that in a second. St. Croix has a rich history of direct action mass struggle, and Harrison's family life and immigrant experience is also very important. His mom comes from Barbados. His father had been born enslaved in St. Croix. So even in St. Croix, he knows the immigrant experience a little bit because, you know, so he knows it from there. So he's got a breadth of perspective even, you know, from his early years. One other thing I want to mention, in the biography, I've been working many, many years on Harrison, but it was very difficult to find information on those early years because some of the records were taken back to Denmark after Denmark, you know, walked away from the Virgin Islands in 1917. The U.S. had some records. They were in Washington. They were in New York. If you go down to the island back then, you couldn't go back more than two generations for the most part and find anything. It was just very difficult to, but within the past 10 to 15 years, through the initiative of a lot of people like people right here in this room, St. Croix African Roots Project was started. They got a little funding from a Danish company, and then people started going through all the records and putting things down and making them available online and organizing it. And ultimately, we were able to do about 10 pages of Harrison's family tree. So it's very interesting. And if people are from St. Croix or they have friends from St. Croix, you want to make sure they know about this because it's a very interesting project. Here's where Harrison's born. He's born in 1883, but this photo is from 1869. But this is the actual plantation he's born on. They're called estates in St. Croix. This is estate Concordia, right? Sugar. That's what they're producing. Harrison spoke about the black people of the Virgin Islands, and he describes how they're almost entirely of African extraction, and the social characteristics are only adequately understood and appreciated by similar reference to characteristics to be found in the West African Negroes from among whom the slaves for the Danish West Indies were drawn, the locale extending from upper Gold Coast to southeastern limits of Nigeria. So he knew a little about the history and would read. As a matter of fact, his children, when they were alive, told me one book he gave to each child was by a fellow named George W. Ellis, and it's Negro Culture in West Africa. So that's what he would, for each child would get their copy of that book, right? On the customs rooted in African communal systems. He talks, among the customs rooted in the African communal system were free public garden on every plantation, which was stocked with fruit trees, various fruit trees. These were to be had for the picking, fishes and shrimps in any gut, that's gutter, short for gutter, you know, where the water would flow, or stream were just as free. Every family of agricultural laborers had its own half acre of provision land on which they would grow things and produce. And the surplus being regularly disposed in the towns on Saturday, that was the market, the communal market, right? In markets that exactly reproduce those to be found today in the hinterlands of Sierra Leone, Liberia, the Cameroons, and Yoruba. And this is purely anecdotal and sidelines, but people are hearing about the Ebola stuff today, right? And these first countries right here is exactly where they're saying it's right now, major, you know, the major numbers are coming out with the Ebola virus. These areas, Sierra Leone and Liberia. In terms of St. Croix's history of direct action mass struggle, St. Croix has an emancipation victory in 1848, which is before the U.S., and it's one of the early ones after Haiti, right, after Saint-Domingue. And the leader is a fellow named Budo, the one who is considered the leader of the movement. But that was, again, the people taking matters into their own hand and pushing for the ending of slavery. In 1878, there was a big island-wide struggle called the Great Fire Burn, right? And it grows into a general strike in 1879. Women of the island played particularly important roles. This is Queen Mary, Thomas, Queen Matilda, Queen Agnes. They were some of the key lead organizers. And if you go to St. Croix today, you'll see the main east-west road is Queen Mary Highway, named after Queen Mary, right? This is Harrison's classmate and friend, D. Hamilton Jackson, year apart there. I think Harrison's a year older than Jackson, who is a major figure in island history. He leads a general strike in 1916. Which prompts Denmark to say, well, we're getting at, you know, and the U.S. is looking to move in anyway because they're on the verge of World War I. The U.S. wants presence down in the Caribbean. But he, you know, is a major figure as a trade union activist and journalist. One other thing about Jackson, he's a lifelong friend of Harrison, so they stay in touch. But one other thing that's important about Jackson is his father was considered just about the finest educator on the island, a public school teacher, right? And Harrison presumably had some contact with the family and this role model, if you will, this educator, this black educator. And this is a very important issue here in New York where, again, last week, one of the public school teachers who was here, Sean, has been doing very active work in New York City because the statistics are about the percentage loss of black and Latin teachers in the public school system. It's a current issue still. But Harrison, I think, benefited from having that close contact with a good black educator, right? This is the village he was born in, Concordia, a very tiny little village. And this photo was 1869, 14 years before he was born. But I went back there in the 90s and took it, and it's the same building. So they just put a little facade on it. So things haven't changed all that much, right? Actually, 2009, it was more recent. The plantation where Harrison was born, Estate Concordia, was owned by two men of color. You would not find that in Virginia. This is post-slavery, right? But it was owned by two men of color. For the most part, you wouldn't find it in Virginia. And this gets at the question of how the color line is drawn differently and how social control is maintained differently in St. Croix than the U.S., but also what I'm going to say applies particularly to Barbados and Jamaica and the Anglo-Caribbean. Yes?
Yeah, that was my question. What about on the other islands?
Yeah, in the Anglo-Caribbean, the Spanish is different again. But Alan stuff we're dealing with in the last few sessions. Alan goes into this in some depth about the difference between the Spanish in the Americas and the English, and particularly the difference between the Anglo control in the southern U.S. and in the Caribbean. And it turns out to be very different, which I'm going to try and hint at right now. And when we get into Alan, we'll go into detail. But I'm going to mention about St. Croix, and you'll quickly see what's different from Virginia and the southern U.S. All right. In St. Croix, when Harrison grows up, there's a policy of promotion, not strict proscription, for a significant sector of the African descended population. That's like the plantation that he's born on, right?
Explain promotion and prescription.
There were laws passed that encouraged acquisition of parcels of land for free coloreds and free Africans, you know, in this period, and they did that because, as I'm going to get to in the next slide, if you will, in the next slide, let's see here. I thought I had them in the right order, but let's do it this way. In St. Croix, the population is roughly 100%, presumably, right? 5% is European, 15% colored of mixed African and European ancestry, and 80% of the population was black, right? Black plantation laborers. This is just in general throughout the 19th century. This is, I mean, these numbers weren't changing so much in the 19th century.
Thank you.
Are those numbers indicative of across the Caribbean?
No. Not one second, Issa. It varies by country, but in general, in the Anglo-Caribbean, these numbers, it's even in this is probably closer to Barbados. Jamaica's a bit, you know, the numbers vary a little bit, but Alan goes into specifics of these numbers. But in the Anglo-Caribbean, where you had sugar production is very capital intensive. You know, capital intensive too. You need mills, right? So it's late, you know. And so what would happen is it was very difficult for poor producers to compete, and, you know, it's a limited area. And that's why, although you had higher percentages of Europeans in Barbados and Jamaica in the early years, they couldn't compete with what was going on, and they'd wind up leaving and going to other islands and things like this. So Barbados, numbers very similar to this. Jamaica's slightly less, but and it's got to do with the historical particulars, but again, folks. Well, it might be different at different times, but I think the European percentage was pretty low. I think it may have been higher in Jamaica than here, not so much higher, but it might have been about that much in Barbados. We can actually look concretely because the numbers are cited in Alan's second volume. Let me just go on for now. Yes, Issa, I'm sorry.
This is the one part of the discussion that, you know, I'm still working with. This prescription, this promotion, this buffer group that's being created, would you say that those who benefited from those two processes came primarily out of the colored section or the black population?
In general, out of the free colored section, right?
Okay, so we're talking about a class of mulattoes, basically, that are the buffer group between the white power elite and the black laboring class at this particular time.
To some degree, yes. Okay, going on. 5% European, 15% colored of mixed European and African ancestry, 80% of the population was black. The 5% could not easily control the 95%, so they sought to utilize the 15% where they could. This was also done in Saint-Domingue, in Haiti. C.L.R. James writes about this. And in contrast, in Virginia, you have the majority of the laboring population in the 17th century are European American laborers, because there hasn't even been a full turn to African laborers yet. So after Bacon's Rebellion, the ruling elite tries to utilize the laboring class European Americans. This is the invention of the white race. And they do so without promoting them out of their class, because there's so many of them, right? Because that'll cut into profits. But just to go on with this for now, so in this setting, the greatly outnumbered European ruling elite, for social control reasons, implemented this policy that I'm describing. Now let me go back and describe it. The policy of promotion, not strict proscription, for a significant sector of the African descended population. I used the example of the Harrison's estate, but another example that people may find of interest, and this is in Allen's volumes, on the eve of emancipation in the 1830s, 23% of the enslaved African people in Jamaica were owned by free people of color. That's a qualitative difference than Virginia, right? 23%. Yeah. Now, that's what the numbers are. Now, there could be a lot more discussion, but it's very different than what we saw in Virginia, right? Now, going on, in St. Croix, there's no formal segregation. There is no history of lynch terror. White supremacy was not as virulent or as organized as in the US. As I mentioned last week, in 1834, in St. Croix, a law was actually passed, an edict of full equality, which at least nominally granted full equality to free coloreds and Europeans. Whereas in contrast, in the United States, the law of the land was the Dred Scott decision, 1856-57, that says no black person has any rights that a white is bound to respect. I'm just hinting, because what we went through last week, when Harrison comes, he comments on it. When Claude McKay comes from Jamaica, he comments on it. McKay says, I never encountered such a bitter racial hatred as I did when I came to this country. Garvey comments on it. All right, so going on, here's what I just said, right? This is what I just went through. So Harrison's recollections of race relations, now even these are not totally consistent with what I'm saying. They're in some degrees. The McKay thing is very consistent, because Harrison, you have to understand about Harrison, Harrison thought he was the equal of anybody, I think, his entire life. So he writes, when he grows up in St. Croix, there were no superior and inferior people on the island, or there were superior, but in no instance were they made so by the color of their skin. He felt he was the equal. And I'm saying the best educator on the island is D. Hamilton Jackson's father. Jackson's pretty dark-skinned like Harrison, right?
And did they teach white children as well? Or mulatto children as well? Or did they teach only in the African?
Well, it depends. Harrison taught at
Jackson's father.
I don't know who Jackson saw, but it's very possible. He was a very good teacher. He might have been teaching. If he's teaching in a private school, it might have been. I'm not sure. All right. But what Harrison points out is the doctrine of chromatic inferiors and superiors was violently thrust, this is what he means, what the U.S. brings, right? Violently thrust upon the islanders by the personnel of the U.S. Naval Administration. This is after 1917 when they come in. Harrison lives for another 10 years, and he's very active with Virgin Islanders here in the U.S. protesting. Because they really came, the U.S. Navy comes down with all these southern, real vicious attitudes. And there's instances of attacks on people in the community and women, and things like that. Just a lot of protest from the Virgin Islanders over the U.S. naval presence. So here's Harrison. Well, this picture was on his daughter's table she had there. It was one she liked. So I use this one for Harrison when he arrives in like a mugshot. 1917, U.S. purchase right prior to World War I and prior to, it's prior to World War I, but prior, it's 1917, and that's when they come in, and they're preparing for World War I, and it's after the 1916 strike. So Harrison arrives in New York, if I recall correctly, it's in September, and it's shortly after New York City had its fourth great race riot, what they call race riots. If forgive me for that, right? And according to Harper's Magazine, which is still published today, black people were seized wherever they were found, particularly in the area from 23rd Street to 42nd Street. It was said a black man couldn't walk in that area without being seized by a mob of whites, right? And Harper's comments, at this time, the opportunities for Negroes in New York are less than they have ever been, and there's little likelihood of immediate change. So this is quite a contrast from St. Croix for Harrison. He's, you know, just coming, right? And when he lives in those apartments on West 62nd Street, they are among the worst tenements in New York. They're described as the meanest tenements. And I find that of interest because there's a thing called the Tenement Museum in New York. And I suggested to them, why don't we do a talk on Hubert Harrison and the tenements on West 60s one time, but I got nowhere. Maybe other people here have some influence and we can do it sometime. The rents were relatively high for what people were getting. They were higher than comparable rents for whites. It's called the San Juan Hill area, if people are familiar with it, because there was it was the period after the San Juan, after the Spanish-American War, and there was a history of sometimes fights between the European Americans and Americans and African Caribbeans in the area. And this, as I indicated before, this stretch had 3,500 people between 60th and 64th Street. This is, Harrison lives on West 62nd, the meanest tenements. These are the new model tenements that are built in 1906 on 63rd Street. For people familiar with Thelonious Monk, he grows up, he's born 20 years after this, right, in the 1920s. And today, to this day, if you come in West 63rd Street from the west side, it's called Thelonious Sphere Monk Way or something like that street. It's still named, they named it, it's named after Monk. And these were the new model tenements. And for New Yorkers, I know you know the reason why. It's because if you had an inside apartment, you got some air because they had a courtyard in the middle, right? You've seen apartments like this. Yeah, that's considered a big innovation, you know, from, you know, nowhere. nowhere. All right.
Was there a lot of immigration during, were there many masses of people coming from the English-speaking character?
This is when it's starting, for the most part, in this period, you know, and Harrison talks about why it's got to do with the sugar production worldwide, you know, the conditions are getting economically much harder. People start to come. But Harrison talks about from St. Croix and from the West Indies in general, in the very early period, it's not so much you're laboring poor. That starts coming even a little later. You know, it's sometimes people who have some access to education and things like
that. Did they know about these conditions in New York that were so much more repressive and difficult than in their...
Well, you say difficult. I mean, it's difficult back home if you can't make a living, too, you know, depending on who it is.
Some land to grow.
Well, some did. Some didn't. People were making a decision. I mean, in Harrison's case, as I tried to think why he wanted to come, well, he had lost his family, he had no job, he had no property, and he had a desire to learn, right? And you could only go up to about a ninth grade education in St. Croix. So for him, I understand clearly. I think other people who write more broadly on Caribbean immigration could probably answer your questions far better than I could, Issa.
That goes back to the 80%. Harrison is coming out of that 80% group. Right. And if he's faced with those conditions, and then there's still, you know, a large aspect of, you know, people who live in St. Croix who are never going to, you know, benefit. That's why I have a little problem with this buffer system, you know, and the deciding of it as having a real significant difference to what is occurring in the Americas, because the outcome of the two slavery systems resulted in the same thing. Black people of color remaining in the lowest classes and their situation not being that improved. And when we bring it to the modern day time, we see black people now bleaching their skin, trying to get white. We still have a buffer in this society that doesn't recognize their blackness, and they are coming out of this 15%. So that's my take on it, and I'm just going to leave it alone at that. But this is the only problem I'm having with the whole discussion and in the reading of Harrison and trying to make that significant difference in the slavery systems, when I don't think differences really, really made a difference other than it protected white people from being slaughtered in the Caribbean by the larger number of black people that existed.
All right. Look, it's slavery in both places. The people who are enslaved, it's vicious. That's not what's being argued. But Harrison and McKay and Garvey, although they might have faced some discrimination from people who were more propertied and landed, it's nothing like what they encounter here. That's the point that's being made. That's the point. Here it's, as you're going to see in the next, I thought I had the slide. Here it's lynching. Here it's lynching. People are getting lynched. Harrison didn't know that back there. It wasn't happening. McKay says when he came here, he never encountered such a vicious white supremacist. But we'll go on for now. We can pick this up later.
What year did Harrison actually come to?
1900.
So it was 17 years prior to the U.S. Naval.
Right, and 17 years, he was 17 years old.
So was he moving back and forth?
No. Harrison never, very good question. Harrison never goes back to St. Croix. One reason is when St. Croix is purchased in 1917, the U.S. immigration policy has, you know, got this very torturous at sometimes history, and they were used to granting possible citizenship to European American people of European ancestry and descent, but St. Croix is a primarily black population, right? So even when the U.S. purchases the Virgin Islands, as Harrison describes, Virgin Islanders were considered citizens in but not of the United States. And he says, even I don't know what that means, you know. And what Rogers points out, and this is very interesting, when Harrison finally becomes a citizen of the U.S. in 1922, if you look on his immigration and naturalization papers, and you've seen pictures of Harrison, he's listed as white, right? You've seen pictures of him, right? And it's because they weren't dealing too much with the, you know, black people coming from the island, you know, and there's probably more to that story, which I'm going to draw out in World War, in Volume 2. But going on.
21, you become the citizen?
22. Employment in New York City. This is what Harrison encounters when he comes to New York, right? For black people, particularly black immigrants, the occupations available, service occupations, unskilled labor, barely subsistence wages, 95% of black workers not unionized, right? Educational opportunities, although New York City had outlawed segregated schools in 84, it was the last major city in the United States to open high schools. The first evening high school in the, quote, Negro district was not until 1905. By 1913, fewer than 200 black high school students attended racially mixed schools in New York. Racial segregation was, white supremacy was rampant throughout the city. There was segregations in all areas of activities and housing, economic power controlled by whites, if you will. No African-American elected officials, right? Segregated black Republican clubs, that was the party that Booker T. Washington was affiliated with, that Charles W. Anderson, and down south, of course, there were lily white Republican parties, right? Black people, although numerous, had no voting rights for the most part.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask. Yeah. Even though you had black Republican parties, is it not consistent that most of the people part of the Republican Party did not have the right to stay
vote? Yeah. And Harrison
just had opportunity to conversate, and most of the politicians or people in office didn't consider their views, or they heard their views, but it wasn't part of their.
In general, that's very much the case. Yes, and so that's the Republicans, right? But they had some patronage. So, for instance, Charles W. Anderson would get, you know, for one or two black leaders, if you will, right? They could dole out some patronage. Booker T. Washington's political machine, the Tuskegee machine, was a patronage machine, amongst other things, right?
But that was based on
ties to powerful whites, you know.
And plus, certain black people did create revenues, and they did have capital. Certain black institutions did make money. Blacks did. There were certain blacks that had money, and it could be used to influence.
And Washington had access to this.
Because the Tuskegee whole thing is because they had money, and then they could trade with the smaller businesses that said, well, at least we could get some of that capital and let them have what they have, so they didn't go.
Right, and some of that money, though, some of the Tuskegee money is coming from the powerful white friends that he's associating with. Just going on now, the Democrats in New York City had a segregated citywide organization called the United Colored Democracy. So there'd be the Democratic Party, Tammany Hall and Machine. Black people had to meet separately. United Colored Democracy, right? This is what he's encountering when he comes here. And they would take orders from white party leaders. This is one of the major differences with St. Croix, and this is the first one of the first issues that Harrison really takes issue with. And when he writes on it in the New York Times, he talks about being shocked. That's the word, right? Again, very different from, and he talks about the oppression my race feels, right? He's talking about the racial oppression, right? This particular one is the year he arrives, four men at one time in Georgia, at least 107 African Americans that year, but there was a period for 20 or 30 years, at least 100 African Americans every year. Here's Harrison, shocked by lynching, horror unknown in St. Croix. And he, again, that takes him to start writing his letters. He would write, in that decade, 12 letters to the New York Times, right? But he's writing on this, but he's also writing on evolution and Charles Darwin, you know, and literary things. I mean, he's, you know, all sorts of topics. And one reason he did this, just from when some of his more personal writing. He writes, when the Negro enters fully into the intellectual life of the white American, the customary barriers based on the tend to break down. This may particularly happen in the press, where they can't see who you are when you're writing, right? So he would write these letters, and if he didn't, you know, sometimes he would identify himself, but sometimes not. But he felt, you know, you can enter more fully. It wasn't an area where you were automatically facing discrimination. In that first decade in New York, Harrison gets involved in very vibrant black working class intellectual circles. These are the type of things I think we want to encourage today. And this was on West 53rd Street, St. Benedict the Moor Church, which I believe is on it's still there, right? St. Benedict the Moor, it's a Roman Catholic church. And down the block was St. Mark's, which is an AME church, right? And they both held lyceums. And they would have speakers come in exactly like what we're doing. And they would have discussions and debates. And again, these are working class people. He's a clerk. Johnny Bruce is a messenger. He's one of the leading black journalists of the late 19th, early 20th century. Also, later on in his elder years, writes for the Negro World, but he writes for many publications, right? And Harrison referred to St. Benedict's Lyceum, the one, again, the building's still there, as the germ of black racial consciousness, where the fiercest opposition in debate could not take from the cordiality of personal friendship. We might have differences we want to discuss, but we can go out and, you know, talk afterwards. And we learn to insist on the right to differ, to criticize, and dissent from that which we believe to be wrong, and to do this openly and publicly without beating the devil round the stump. Again, I think that's the type of atmosphere we want to create today.
Precluding theology.
Huh?
So is he stating that they precluded theology? They left out the temperament of God?
No, not necessarily here. He's not saying that. But what he also points out, and I don't have in these quotes, he goes, this was one of the first places where African Americans and Afro-Caribbeans could come and really start interchanging and, you know, working. Because, you know, as often the case, you know, when you got a new immigrant group, there's still frictions and things like this. So this was a real meeting place and a coming together. Very important, right? Other people involved in these lyceums, I just want to mention, and forgive me, I don't have a better photo. This is George Young, another Pullman porter like J.A. Rogers, and he's a bookseller. He had a stand on 135th Street, Books in Black History, 8,000 to 12,000 books, right? And he's active particularly with St. Mark's Lyceum. So these are your work. This is that tradition in the black community of passing it on, and the education community oriented, which we continue to see, and we've seen throughout, particularly this century, last century. Here's Charles Burroughs, who I mentioned earlier, founds the Creek. This is one of the major early black theater groups, right? And he's the postal worker with Harrison. They do the study groups, and in Harrison's diary, he's talking about their study groups and how they correspond down in Cuba, right? With activists in Cuba, because this was the period of the Black Party of Independence in Cuba. Yeah, I mean, it's some fascinating stuff and connections people might want to make. To make and develop. Here's Williana Jones Burroughs, a more close picture, the woman I talked about in the back of the photo, the group photo. This is very important. Harrison, he starts working in the post office in 1907, but he also works at the White Rose Home for Colored Women, I think was the full title. And this was a major social work institution in New York, where black women coming from the Caribbean or from down south could come to New York. They would have a safe place to stay, very, you know, not expensive. If they had young children, there was a kindergarten class and there was some daycare. And it was run, this woman right here, was started by a woman named Victoria Earle Matthews, one of the leading black journalists and civil rights activist of the late 19th century. But the woman who took it over right here is Frances Reynolds Kaiser. And she, Mrs. Kaiser, her husband dies when she's very young, when they're young. And she is reportedly, I believe, the first black woman to graduate from what is now Hunter College, right? She's very, very bright. She is close enough friends with Paul Laurence Dunbar, leading poet of the late 19th, early 20th century, that he sends his manuscript to her before sending it off to the publisher. She is such close personal friends with Hubert Harrison that when he makes his break from religion, which I'll describe in a second, it's a very torturous break, right? But he describes it in a letter to her, you know? So he's very close friends with her. And then when she leaves here in the, after, I think around 1910, 1911, she goes down to Florida and is the principal aide and assistant to Dr. Mary McLeod Bethune, right, in the woman in the school down in Daytona, right? So she's a major figure. She's also, I believe, president of the Empire State Federation of Negro Women's Clubs. She's a central committee member of the NAACP. She's a woman very much in need of a biography, right, in case anyone here is getting inspired. But so what Harrison did at this White Rose home is, and this is all part, and I hope I have the quote, he wanted to get in full touch with the life of his people, right? You know, and so he's working there for no pay. He's teaching kindergarten kids, and he talks about the 4 and 5 year olds, but he's teaching Negro history to the women at night, right? And so he's very involved. This is another one of the areas where he works in the community. But he explains, we'll see if the quote comes. Here's a close-up of Frances Reynolds Kaiser, right? And here's what Harrison writes, and this is from his diary, I believe. He sets out around 1907, 8, 9 to write a history of black people, right? And a history of the American Negro that will bring a knowledge of psychology and sociology, that will be a storehouse of information, but not simply an encyclopedia, bringing something of the philosopher's insight. And thus, how's he going to go about writing it? My haunting of the YWCA. These were colored Ys, right? YWCA, YMCA. The White Rose Home, disreputable clubs, streets of evil, sort of my social work amongst the children of 62nd Street, my revival, my attendance at revival meetings and prayer meetings, and so on. All of this, by putting me in full touch with the life of my people, will aid me in understanding them better and fit me to write their history. So he, what Gramsci would call an organic intellectual, perhaps, you know, he's really rooted in the community that he's right, you know. And so that's, again, that's not an intellectual from on high. That's not walking around Washington, D.C. with a top hat and cane, right? All right. This is his wife, Irene Louise Horton Harrison. She comes from, I believe her ancestors are from Demerara, which is a region in Guyana where Africans would escape for freedom in present-day Guyana. But we know she comes from Antigua via Puerto Rico to here. So she comes from the Caribbean like that. And they wind up getting married, I believe it's in 1909. And I have this one photo from daughter Ada, who's on the right. They wind up having five children, four girls and a son. When I started doing my research in the 80s, Ada, who was born in 1914, was still alive, and her brother William, who was born in 1920, was alive. They passed since then, but I'm in very much touch with the grandchildren and great-grandchildren. This is the block where Harrison lives for much of his time in Harlem. When he moves to Harlem, it's in 1907, it's after the IRT is completed. He moves up to Harlem, the IRT, the subway, right, the subway line. And that's when there was a big movement of blacks from that area in the West 60s, the area near Lincoln Center, up to Harlem. He lives at 231 West 134th Street. When he lives there, as I said earlier, it's the most densely populated block in Harlem. I took this photo, I believe, around 1990. That's why it's in the condition it is, because that was when the crack thing was encouraged, if you will, by government officials. You know, they're letting a lot of this stuff in. He starts his diary in 1907. And I think, again, I want to share some of this Harrison with you, so forgive me and allow me. But when he writes his diary, and he keeps it for the remainder of his life, and the background on the diary is, when I first met the family in 1981, on the third meeting, and the son was living up on Bradhurst, off 150th Street off Bradhurst, right? Yeah, that's where he was, in Harlem. When I first met the family, on the third meeting, they said, come into the front room, because I had shown them a few hundred pages I had started writing on Harrison, and they said, here. And they gave me his papers, which they had preserved in that apartment. Essentially, they moved a little, but essentially since the son had moved there. But the papers had been preserved since 1927. And it was all kinds of scrapbooks, books, manuscripts. And I immediately, as I indicated last week, I preserved them. I got archival boxes, Mylar, acid-free paper. I preserved them. I made copies. I worked from the copies. I tried not to ever touch the originals. Ultimately, they were placed at Columbia University, family decision, family, you know, got all the money and everything like that. But they gave me all the papers, I thought, as far as I knew, and that was in around 81 or 82. But then, after I had finished I finished my orals. I'm working in a post office, but I'm going to school, right? And I had finished orals, maybe my dissertation. I go out to dinner with his 75-year-old daughter. You know, we're going to celebrate. We finally got this far. And she reaches into her bag and she goes, oh, here's one more thing for you, Jeff. And it was his diary, which I didn't know existed. Major document because I'm going to show you why it's so major. But he keeps, this is the second volume. The first one was lost somewhere along the way. It goes from 1907 till his death in 1927. But read what he writes when he starts his diary. It must surely be instructive to look back after long years on one's past thoughts and deeds and form new estimates of ourselves and others. Seen from another perspective, large things grow small, small ones large, and lives of relative importance are bound to change position. At any rate, it must be instructive to compare the impression of the moment, laden as it may be with the bias of feeling and clouded by partisan or personal prejudice, with the more broad and impartial review which distance in time or space makes possible. This may serve me in some sort as a history of myself, twisted by two threads, what I do and what I think. I hope I shall not make any conscious effort to impress upon its character, or to impress upon it a character of any sort. So far as my life is concerned, as it comes, so it must be set down. And if I omit any one phrase of my life experience, I do so for judicial reasons and not for the sake of seeming better in my own eyes when memory has ceased to testify. It's a very objective biography. And it comes with both a sense of his, you know, that he's doing work of importance, but also with an understand. I'm always moved by this, you know, when you look back 40 or 50 years, some things loom large, other things recede. Even if you go to a high school reunion or something like that, you know, all of a sudden, you know, things change a little. And it's nice that he has this recorded history of it. And I'm eager to get that full diary out there because it's just, I mean, it. And this is where he gets into, I mean, you talk about the inner thoughts on Garvey and things like this. This is it's in his diary, right? So now we're going on. In this same period, he writes the following, pledge to the mother race from an untamed, untamable African. I believe this was in the diary. And it opens, poor heart sore and soul starved mother race, who shall minister to thy deep desires? Who shall bind up thy wounds and raise thee up again? O Africa, when shall be the term of thy long degradation? Behold, even now I pledge thee, O my mother, that I shall devote my years to thee, shall work for redemption even in the land of thine exile, and set before mine eyes an ideal of service to thee, inextricably blent with service for myself. And then at the bottom, take my youth, my labors, my love, my life, my all, and do thou, when I shall have died for thee, take me to thy bosom, an untamed, untamable African. This is Harrison, his pledge to service. You know, just why I find this so important. Well, it's a very moving and powerful document, but if you go online, you'll find it's on the homepage, or it was on the webpage, of Asada Shakur in Cuba, right? She chose this one to put up there, right? So, an untamed, untamable African. Very good stuff, I think. All right. So, now you've been, how are we doing? We're okay so far? maybe another 30 minutes today, and then we'll pick it up again next week. Hubert Harrison's Break from Religion. In that letter to Frances Reynolds Kaiser, the woman I mentioned, he talks about how he broke from religion. And this is significant for Harrison because this enables him to really start taking a more radical approach to social matters. He's going to address them as a social scientist. He's you know, not based on religious dogma. He's going to try and really analyze social issues and problems. So he writes, I divorced myself from Orthodox and institutional Christianity. I suffered. Oh, how my poor wounded soul cried out. This is a break. This is a worldview he's breaking from. It's not necessarily an easy thing, right? I saw the whole fabric of thought and feeling crumbling at its very foundations. What had gone was the authenticity of the Bible. And he went back. This was the period in the early 20th century of what's called historical criticism, when people were really going back and rigorously looking at Bible, biblical text, and, you know, seeing how they stood up to historical fact. So he says, I had a new belief, agnosticism. I said belief, but what I meant was a philosophy of life. Now I am an agnostic, such as an agnostic as Thomas Huxley was, and my principles are the same. Thomas Huxley is Charles Darwin's bulldog. That's what he's referred to. He's a big proponent of evolution. And I'm going to show you what. And he's the founder of the word agnostic. Now, later on, Harrison will also describe himself as an atheist, right? But the coiner of the phrase agnostic is Huxley. And here's what Huxley says. To Huxley, agnosticism was not a creed, but a method, the essence of which was the fundamental axiom of modern science. Follow your reason as far as it will take you. Do not pretend that conclusions are certain which are not demonstrated or demonstrable. And let's see, this keeps dying, but I think we make it through. Like Huxley, Harrison refused to put faith in that which does not rest on sufficient evidence. He chose to look the universe in the face and to develop a sense of responsibility for his actions. In his diary, Harrison concluded that he would probably never be anything but an honest agnostic because, as he wrote, I prefer to go to the grave with my eyes wide open. Just one sec. And I haven't made a decision yet, but I've thought about doing volume two as having that as the subtitle, Eyes Wide Open.
Yeah, I just want to humanize Hubert Harrison in the eyes of those who would discount him because of his religious beliefs. He did say that he pondered his soul. And I thought that was very important to know that he was that deep to give consideration to his spiritual side.
Okay, moving on. In this period, 1907, 1908, 1909, 1910, Harrison starts, besides the black study circles and the white Rose Home and the Y and all of that stuff, he starts interacting in circles with European Americans. I mean, he's been to some degree, but he becomes more active. One was something called the Sunrise Club, which would have dinners usually every 2 weeks in Manhattan, and they'd have guest speakers. Sometimes it'd be Du Bois, you know, it could be one of the leaders of the Socialist Party, generally progressive speakers, but they were interracial, and this was unusual in New York, right? And one of the driving forces was this fellow named Edwin C. Walker. This was part of Harrison's coming more and more in contact with the free thought movement. Again, for people not familiar, thought free of religious dogma. They emphasized the human origins of the Old and New Testaments, denied the infallibility of the Bible, denied the existence of heaven and hell. They advocated free inquiry, free discussion, free publicity of ideas, and the scientific method. In amongst their slogan, they had a publication in New York called the Truth Seeker. Excuse me. It supported free speech, free press, free mails, but it also demanded taxation of church properties. Not a bad demand, huh? Discontinuance of military chaplains, excuse me. Complete separation of church and state, end to school prayers, end to blue laws, and end to courtroom oaths. It supported science, all right, unfortunately. And the period from 1875 to 1914 is considered the high watermark of free thought in this country, right? So Harrison was, it's one of the more current thoughts, you know, of the era, and he's in tune with it. People may not be familiar with some of the people who were free thinkers, but amongst those who were free thinkers, leading figures in the women's movement, Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony, Margaret Sanger, Robert G. Ingersoll, the great agnostic, right? Horace Greeley, Thomas Wentworth Higginson, people may remember from the brigade he led in the Civil War, right? The Black Brigade, the movie, I think there was a movie, right? Made on that. Clarence Darrow, the attorney, Eugene V. Debs, the socialist, Mark Twain, Lucy Parsons, and Emma Goldman. And people may not know these names, but these were the two first leaders of the Communist Party, Louis Freina and Charles E. Ruthenberg, right? But they were also important black free thinkers. And there's more. I cut this list down, but J.A. Rogers, Claude McKay, Cyril Briggs, Richard B. Moore, and W.E.B. Du Bois. And this is according to David Levering Lewis. But see, it's not emphasized so much in how Du Bois gets projected. But according to David Levering Lewis, Du Bois was an agnostic and an anti-clerical, right? But sometimes, you know, images are projected one way for a host of various reasons. But again, these sources are all in the biography. I have the where I'm getting this from. Okay, as a free thinker, now when Harrison turns to free thought, Hodge Kiernan, one of his friends, a fellow from Montserrat, considered Harrison the first and foremost Negro in the cause of free thought, and most people do. He's a pioneer black activist in this movement. He was attracted by its critical approach, its focus on scientific as opposed to religious thought. He would read throughout the remainder of his life a host of things by free thinkers and agnostics and atheists. He'd read the Truth Seeker, the Rationalist Press, a number of writers. He would write on Moncure D. Conway was also wrote about evolution, and Harrison would write about Conway, one of his letters to the Times. He would also lecture before, at the bottom, again, before the Secular League on truth versus superstition, some fallacies of free thought. So he's not, even when he moves to free thought, it's not like it's a blanket, you know, everything they say is right and stuff. He's questioning and critical even there, right? Going on. Okay, now we start moving into his involvement with some of the national black leaders. Harrison is working in the post office. Booker T. Washington is the most powerful black man in America by virtue of his ties to powerful whites and that Tuskegee machine. Harrison kept scrapbooks, I mentioned them, and he has Booker T. Washington in a scrapbook he labeled subservience, right? Subservience. Listen to this quote from Booker T. Washington regarding President Theodore Roosevelt. He goes, this is what Booker T. says, "I will oppose nothing that he wants done and will forward all that he desires to have done." A cite for that is in the book. But that would certainly qualify, one would think, as a subservient, right? And Harrison had differences with a lot of Washington's philosophy, his attitude towards trade unions, a host of things. Booker T. Washington goes to Europe in 1910. He goes to London and Copenhagen. And he issues some pronouncements on conditions for black Americans in the U.S., basically saying that conditions are not that bad for black people in the U.S. This is a period of lynching, segregation, disfranchisement. W.E.B. Du Bois, in his early years, there had been the open struggle between W.E.B. Du Bois and Booker T. Washington, you know, particularly around the time of the Niagara Movement and afterwards. And Harrison in his early years refers to himself as a Du Bois man. I'm on that side of that debate, you know. So he's siding with Du Bois, you know, on that. And he's critical of Booker T. Washington. So Washington issues these statements in Europe. And Du Bois, very prominent, he's the editor of the Crisis magazine, 1910. That's when it gets founded, right? The magazine of the NAACP. He pulls together about 50 prominent people to issue protests about Booker T. Washington's statements when he made in Europe. Very powerful effort, you know, to protest. Harrison's working in the post office, worker, right? Writes two letters to the New York Sun, one of New York's dailies. And basically what he says in those letters, he goes, "Well, Booker T., you're free to say what you want, but you should tell the truth." And then he runs what's really going on. Now, it was a little tough for Booker T. to take on Du Bois and all of that array of people, but Harrison was far more vulnerable. So this is Booker T. That's his right hand, Emmett Scott. His person in New York was the leading black Republican, part of his Tuskegee machine. That's Charles W. Anderson, who was very good friends with a fella named Edward Morgan. Now, for those who live in New York, you go to 29th Street and 10th Avenue, the biggest post office in New York is Morgan Station. It's named after Morgan, right? And it used to have 6,000 workers when I was active. Now they've been cutting back on the postal workforce. But these people get together and they decide, you know, and this is from Booker T. Washington's diary. And the documents are publicly available and I have the links. But basically what happens is they work to have Harrison summarily fired from the post office. Now, as I said, I'm a postal worker, and I was also a union steward, and I knew how to dig and get these records. He had a clean, what they call POD-7. That's a postal record. You go to St. Louis, you can get these things. And he's summarily fired for speaking out. Now, this is a really dastardly thing to do to anybody, because at the time, Harrison and his wife have three children, and she's pregnant with the fourth, and they're going to have a fifth, right? Remainder of his life, the family lives in poverty. There's been a new book came out a couple years ago. Let's take a fresh look at Booker T, you know. But they don't mention things like this. But I don't think, I'm trying to write biography of Harrison. You got to, warts and all, you got to tell the whole story because that's how we're going to learn from this, right? So, now, also in this period, I'm trying to position Harrison for people in terms of Booker T, Du Bois, the NAACP and everything. NAACP gets founded. There had been, quote, race riots, rebellions, race riots, 1909 in the Midwest, that prompted the effort to get people together to found a new civil rights organization. And they have some meetings in New York at a place called Charities Hall where European Americans, African American prominent people come together to start talking about setting up this organization. And when they have these meetings, there's some reports come out in the press. And Harrison reviews the reports and issues a warning that this is not the way you want to start this organization because in the reports, some of the most pointed comments by the black participants were elided. They were taken out of the documentation. So he says, that's not the way you want to start this organization. You don't want to shape it to white people's expectations of how black people should act, right? And that would remain a constant concern of his, because he would, throughout the decade, raise the issue that the NAACP had no answer to what it was going to do if the white minds it was trying to reach didn't respond, right? And that's why he would start later on in the decade, put out a call, black people, we have to be more proactive ourselves. We can't wait around, right? So that's some of his early criticisms of the NAACP. Now, Du Bois becomes editor of the Crisis magazine in 1910. That's the organ of the NAACP. Du Bois, as we know, is associated with the concept the talented tenth, the educated and gifted, this is from Du Bois, right, who must be made leaders of thought and missionaries of culture among their people. Harrison had some problems with this concept. He didn't think the talented tenth had provided the leadership that was needed. He thought that they should come down from their Sinais and get amongst the people. And he didn't think that the colored leadership was preordained to lead. And there are statistics, and I cite them, who were the talented tenth, you know, and this is what I think Issa was hinting at earlier. And it was largely people of mixed ancestry, you know, European, African. And Harrison later on probes a little more deeply, because when he starts writing more on this, he says you can't move from the assumption that a touch of white blood preordained somebody to be a leader of the Negro race. You know, he gets into this later. But it's not mean-spirited, but he's making some important points. But on the talented tenth, right, Harrison emphasized education, self-development of the common people. He did not think such a talented tenth was in any way preordained to lead the Negro race, right? I think that's a repeat. All right, so that's just an early foreshadowing of things that are going to happen in this decade. Yes?
Can you give them the credit due for making sure that they capitalize that word color at the particular time?
Harrison pushed to have the Negro capitalized. That's coming later, yeah. And a matter of fact, he writes letters and prods the socialist press into beginning to capitalize the N in Negro, right? And this is Harrison, 1911, 1912. That's later on. But a little before I get there, I just want to point out, in this period around 1911, he also starts delivering a series of talks on Abraham Lincoln. And now, Harrison takes the approach, Lincoln did some important things, right? But he wasn't, you know, all perfect. He wasn't all that, right? And he made some statements that Harrison was very critical of. And he thought that particularly African Americans had to be clear, because there was much blind loyalty, if you will, to the Republican Party. Frederick Douglass had said, the Republican Party is the ship, all else is the sea, because it was the party of emancipation and liberation. But this is 40 years later, and they're keeping Lily White down south, and you know they're not doing all that much, right? And so Harrison wants to push in the way of more political independence. And so he writes about Lincoln, and he talks about some of the good things Lincoln does, but also quotes some Lincoln. So for instance, this one, and Lincoln says, I am not in favor of Negro citizenship. You know, and he gives dates and stuff. I'm sorry, I don't have it all here. I have no objection to the proposed 13th Constitutional Amendment. This is the original 13th Amendment, right? People don't know this history. Prohibiting federal interference with slavery being made express and irrevocable. There's a thing called the Crittenden Amendment related to this in the original 13th Amendment. I go into it in the biography. People don't know about this one, but that one was going to make slavery forever, you know, right? And this last one, my paramount object of this struggle is to save the Union and is not either to save or destroy slavery. This is Lincoln, right? If I could save the Union without freeing any slave, I would do it. Just a couple of things on this. First, Harrison's general approach to Lincoln, we see many years later in Lerone Bennett Jr., editor of Ebony Magazine, who writes this book on Lincoln, but he gets blasted, right? I mean, you know, when he comes out with it. But it's a much more, let's take a deeper look at what Lincoln's really saying and stuff like that. Although other historians now write it and they get treated differently. But when Bennett said it or when Harrison, you know, this was really, Harrison, this is real pioneering. I spoke with Bennett about it. I saw Bennett at a conference, I think in Cincinnati or something, and I asked him, he didn't know about the Harrison, you know, writing those pieces, but so it would have been a nice connection. But this slogan right here, Susan, before you leave, another Union story. Okay. My paramount object in this struggle. In 1926, Harold Cruz in The Crisis of the Negro Intellectual talks about a struggle at the Lafayette Theater in 1926. And this is basically the struggle. It concerns the motion picture operators. They have a black auxiliary. It's not an official part of the union, right? Meets separately and everything like this. And the unionists decide that in the interest of the union, they want the black workers to go out on strike, right? So Harrison's covering this struggle, and to make the story short, he writes a couple of pieces in the Amsterdam News about it. And this is also, for those familiar with left history, this is in the period when Lasovsky, who's the head of the Red International of Trade Unions, says that the U.S. Communist Party is, quote, dancing quadrilles around the AFL. They're playing footsie with the AFL. They're not taking a very militant stand in terms of labor. But Harrison writes this piece in the 1926 Amsterdam News, and when he's covering that strike, you got this kind of real racist white supremacist union, right? Not full rights for the African Americans. They want them to go out on strike. So Harrison says, in this struggle, my paramount of this struggle is not to save the union, but to free the slaves, right? You know, I mean, he stands that quote from Lincoln on its head. Sorry if I got a little tortured in that. Okay, when Harrison joins the Socialist Party around 1908, 1909, 1910, we haven't still located exactly the smoking gun document when he joins. It's important for people to understand the Socialist Party, which proclaimed itself as the party of the working class, was a significant and a growing party. It had 40,000 members. It got 400,000 votes, which at that point was 3% of the voting population. 1912, it went up to 6%, so it doubled, so it was growing, right? And that's the period when Harrison's doing a lot of campaigning. Its platform is one we could certainly use today, aspects of it. It's anti-monopolies and trusts, pro-nationalization of industry, proponent of the 8-hour workday, which we didn't have that, pushing for a progressive income tax, rich pay more. The only party that was a supporter of women's suffrage, right, in that period, of the major parties, right, and a public works program. Again, things we could use today. African Americans, it's about 12. I'm going to just do one or two more slides today, and we'll see if there's any questions, and next week we'll pick up Harrison more. Does that sound reasonable? I mean, people, all right. When Harrison joins the Socialist Party, it had few black members. It had no special program. When Harrison joins, perhaps 1% of the Socialist Party was black, right? 1%. Had a weak record on Negro question, opposed reforms needed in the African-American community. There was a range of debate within the Socialist Party, from outright, out-white racist advocacy. One of the leading activists down south writes a book, "End Heaven," you know, and when we go to 1912 and Harrison's putting out a call for doing more work, you see some of the most racist comments in the history of the left in the debates in the Socialist Party. Victor Berger, who's a very prominent person from Wisconsin, had been elected to Congress, had argued as far back as 1902 that Negroes and mulattoes constitute a lower race. Ernest Unterman, another leading theoretician in the party, "I am determined that my white race shall be supreme in this country and the world." This is the socialist, right? And the other quotes like that. So I go through those. Let me see. We get a... let me go one or two more minutes. We're wrapped. Okay, there were major ideological differences in the party. Just like when I grow up in the 70s, people argue, you know, the certain issue is very important and people fighting over it all the time. Within the Socialist Party, the two main issues Well, would socialism come by evolution, you know, gradually, or by revolution? And that raised issues both in the electoral arena, how you approached electoral politics, and in the trade union movement, how you approached trade union work. So, and the party, their official platform opposed reform work and said they weren't going to do it, but in fact they did, right? And the key thing regarding the trade union question, they all agree we should support industrial unions, but what was the debate was over, should they support the AFL, and the, because some of these AFL unions were lily white and things like that, and there was much difference of opinion, because there was also the IWW, which was militant and preached, you know, racial equality and everything like that. But the Socialist Party took a position that they were not going to interfere in the internal politics of the organizations. So what Harrison would do, and I'll wrap it with this section, is he tried, understanding these differences in the party, he tried to appeal to both wings with the importance of the struggle against white supremacy and the Negro question. And this is where we see this thread coming through Harrison later with Allen and stuff, that this is the key question. So he argues, he proposes a new, in his writings, he proposes a new litmus test for U.S. socialists to champion the cause of the Negro. So to the two factions, he tried to speak to them in their own language. He says, for the political social, if the power of the voting proletariat is what you're interested in, you need black votes, right? You need black votes. And if you wanna, to the labor people, he goes, if you want to organize at the point of production, you need black workers, right? He's trying to argue in both these cases. We'll leave it there. Next week, I'll talk about what he learns from the role of foreigners and women in the party, because these were groups that started getting special attention paid, right? They set up women's clubs and foreign language federations, and Harrison sees that. And he says, why don't we do something to address, you know, the situation for black people, right? So that we'll pick it up. Hope people can come back next week. It's been 2 hours, so. I have a meeting today at 2, so I have to get there. But I certainly will handle any questions now if people have them, or any thoughts, any feedback, suggestions. We okay? Yes. I'm a product of the 60s, and you know, I was getting politically, politically exposed, learned a lot, you know, along the way. And one thing that happened was in 1969, it used to be a place, so it's a lot from personal experience, right? But it was a place in 1969 in a village called Alternate U. Maybe some of the folks here go back to this place. It was like an alternate, you know, radical place. It was, you know, 60s. And Theodore W. Allen, the fellow who we talk about next few weeks, we'll talk about more, gave a course there. And in that course, he laid out some of his work from the 60s, including when he looked, he wrote a piece called, workers, crossed out, radicals, be radicalized. And in that piece, he looked at a history of the left. He looked at a history of left and labor historians writing about the left and the rationales they gave for why no socialism in this country. And he looked through all the rationales and he punched holes in each one and he said, look, this rationale doesn't hold in light of white supremacy. You got to focus on this, right? And he drew it back down to how white supremacy was really the key retardant to social progress, and it's the issue we had to take them on. So he draws that, and he goes through all the leading, in this time, left and labor historians and what they've written. And so that influenced me, and he does another thing, which I talked about last week, but since you weren't here, I'll do real quick. He looks at three previous crises in U.S. history to see what lessons could be learned. And those are the periods of the 1870s, the 1890s, and the 1930s. And what he found was that in each crisis, in each period, as the people from below started to struggle to push for change, the ruling elite in this country turned to white supremacy to beat down those efforts. Very briefly, in the Depression, a quick example, all the major labor legislation, Fair Labor Standards Act, National Labor Relations Act, Social Security until 1951, exclude domestic and agricultural workers, black and Latin workers. GI Bill, New York area, 67,000 GI loans, less than 100 go to families of color. That's how you get the white suburbs around New York and everything. The black to white unemployment ratio in 1929 was 1-1. Makes sense. Black people are brought here to work. 1947, after all the programs of the New Deal and the post-war deployment, it's 2-1. That's all you and I have ever known, right? The black to white unemployment ratio. Federal ruling class government policy, right? And so he alerted me to the centrality of the question of white supremacy, and he also made very important arguments, essentially, whatever the jargon of the day, the words, that racism is not innate, and be clear that the European-American workers don't benefit from this. This is not in their real interest, right? Not in their class interest, right? They're fed that it is. With those perspectives, I started writing on why no socialism in the left, and I started looking at all the left organizations from the turn of the 20th century, and I'm researching them all, and then I came across Harrison, and at the Schomburg Center, he had two books, When Africa Wakes and Negro and Nation, and back then you would print them out, they're on microfilm, you print them out, you take them home and you read them, and I was arrested by the clarity of his thought. I had read all the contemporaries, and he was head and shoulders above all of them. Now, I want to say, I'm not the only one who had this reaction. Winston James, who I mentioned earlier, is an excellent historian, said, Jeff, he had the exact same reaction. You read Harrison, read him in his own words. I mean, I try and do him justice, but mostly I let him speak because he's that good, right? He's head and shoulders, and he understood all this. He understood the centrality of the struggle against white supremacy. He understand who gains from white supremacy. He was addressing all the key issues and other things which we'll get into, his notion of the touchstone, which we talked about last week. Politically, the Negro is the touchstone of the modern democratic idea, touchstone. Black stone, you rub it against gold to see if it's really the gold it's purported to be. Every issue we look at, that's the test, you know. He came with direction. He had this Richard. So I got interested in him. I tracked down his family, and then all new worlds opened up. It wasn't like I set out to write about Harrison or anything like that. Sorry if I went off too long. Yes. At the 1870s, the 1890s and 1930s. But what I want to point out again, I want to emphasize: if you go to my webpage, on the top left, my webpage is simply my name, Jeffrey B. Perry. There's an article, Developing Conjuncture and Insights from Harrison. I go through all of this with detail and footnotes. So you can Google populism. You can Google depression, right? You know, and I mean, not Google. You go to that page. It's a PDF. You bring it up, and then you can just search within the document. You'll find it very easily. Yeah, thank you.
Any thought of Harrison being offered, you know, in a class form at Columbia? Are there any thoughts?
Well, not that I know of right now. I mean, I did this. Some people, you know, said, Russell, who friends with Michael and stuff, said, Jeff, that, you know, they were setting up programs here. Why don't you come and do this? So I was pleased to be able to do it. But I'm actually trying, as you know, to finish volume 2 of Harrison, to get all, you know, I'm getting older, right? I want to get all 700 of his writings up on the web. And then I want to get all Allen's stuff out. So I got these major projects. It may not really, but this stuff takes me a while to prepare, you know, and I got to, how you want to order it and stuff like that. So I right now, no, and I'm not necessarily looking for classes. What I'm hoping, and what Fred is very good at, and Marlo now, we've got this videoing, and if we can, you know, put it in workable form, you know, if I misspeak or something, you know, we clean it up a little, but we get it out there, and then people can use this, because the one that Fred did on the invention of the white race, that one, it's been running, and it's been getting quite a number of real significant numbers every day for months and months and months. And if you go, for instance, to Black Agenda Report or anything like that, and you hit right there, they bring you right to Allen stuff. And they were ready to run this article I had for them last week on Harris, and I told them, hold off for a second, we want to seasoning. So we're getting it out. I mentioned last week, In the Harrison biography, which came out in 2008, I mentioned when I started Googling Hubert Harrison around 2003, 2004, Hubert Harrison, Hubert H. Harrison, all of that came to about 750. Now it's like 150,000. Allen's a quarter of a million. It is coming because they both speak with great integrity. They understand the key issues. They're speaking to what we need. They're going to continue to grow. Again, if you weren't here last week, I went in a little to how the university's not quite ready for it yet. One of the key things is you got a lot of people in the university, if they've been teaching for a long while and not mentioned Harrison or Allen, it's tough for them to all of a sudden come and say, gee, these people are really important. So the push is going to come from community, from younger people, you know, who are going to insist, look, this is too important, you know. That's what I think, you know. Yes?
Jeff, I have to go put money in the meter before I get a ticket. But there is that event I brought in.
Yes, I read it early.
You did?
Yes.
You let everyone know.
Yes. The date was the
September? The 24th of September, Roxanne Dunbar-Ortiz, right, was just written a book called An Indigenous People's History of the United States, right, will be speaking, and she has that book.
Right here, it's in the evening.
It'll be 7:30 here. Right.
I said it early, but thank you, Michael. Very, very important.
I just wanted to remind
and
everyone.
How are we? You're coming back, right? You'll help us close up, right?
That's what I get.
Okay,
I got to do my meter.
Yes, hi.
What were the names of the two women social workers related to the White Rose home?
Frances Reynolds Kaiser, K-E-Y-S-E-R. If you look in the Harrison book, the index, I worked hard on the index. You'll find it very easily. And the other one was Victoria Earle Matthews. Earle, I believe, has an E at the end, Matthews,
okay,
right? I don't know that I have to get into all of that right now, but what I would say is one reason I do these courses and these classes is I don't think the left in all its various forms is where we want it to be, right? And I think, I'm not hidden about this, I think the left we need to build at the very center core of whatever program and strategy it has to be this understanding that white supremacy is central to how the ruling classes maintain control. And in the context of the class, you know, we got to deal with this white supremacy. We can't ignore it. It's not going away. We got to take them on. What Allen argues, as I said last week, it's what they rely on, but it's also ultimately their most vulnerable point. It's the one we can beat them on. You know, but we got to do a lot of organizing. And unfortunately, I don't see so many groups with that understanding. Even some of the prominent left groups, they'll have a laundry list of what they're opposed to. Maybe number 7 is racism. You know, it's not with that focus that we get from Harrison and Allen. And I think it's only by that understanding, what I'm articulating here, and putting it in practice, that the real leadership we need will emerge. Now, regarding putting it in practice, Marlo, but for people who may be interested, I have on my webpage a few sections down from that article on developing conjuncture, I talk about work we did in the post office. I come out of a 4,000 worker facility in Jersey City. We actually tried to put this in practice, where every issue, how is white supremacy shaping it? What are we going to do about it? We built some wonderful working relationships in the joint, as we called it, right? The 4,000 worker place. We coordinated the statewide anti-apartheid. You know, we took on we took on organized crime. We were fighting the good fight. We did much, much good work. So I, for one, am very, you know, convinced that this stuff can be done. You know, you can do it. You can see results. And Jersey City and Bayonne, as I mentioned last week, is not far different than sections of Brooklyn. You know, it is a lot of polarization, right? But it can be done. It can be done. But I think you need to, and when you first start doing it, people look and it's just for real, you know, and you know, people want to get, you know, all kinds of situations developed. But if you're clear and you push forward, I think progress can be made. So. Good. Thank you all very much. Next Saturday at 10. You all right? Coming back?
Oh, yeah.